were born?
My name is Charles Mott. I was born in Seton Hospital on December 30th, 1942. My mother was the youngest daughter of Henry Whelan and Wilhelmina Flasher Whelan. They were second generation Texans, having come from Germany. And my mother had married my father a week after Pearl Harbor. That was in 1941. And then my dad was shipped off to many different places over the ensuing years, but I did not see him until I was 3 years old, and of course he didn't see me until I was 3 years old. But I was born in Seton Hospital, which was a little bit unusual in those days, but my mother being the youngest girl and only 18 years old at the time, I'm guessing that she convinced everybody she needed to go to the hospital to have the baby. So that's where I was born. Then I was brought back as a child to live and grow up on the old Whelan farm, which was north of south of Pflugerville, about 3 miles, in the Dessau community. Now, it was, I don't remember much about those 3 years. I do remember one occasion, and I suspect I was about 3 years old, when my mother was out milking a cow, and I was standing around somewhere, and all of a sudden I felt this splash of warm milk in my face as she squeezed the udder in it directed, and she just laughed, and of course it surprised me that that milk was so warm. But that's where I grew up my first 3 years.
Your grandfather was Henry Whelan, and his the Whelans immigrated from Germany in the 1850s. And tell us a little bit about the Whelan homestead that Martin Whelan built.
Well, I really was, I don't know a whole lot about it except that my mother grew up there in her younger years, and it was situated a little, again, south of Pflugerville, it was built out of stone, and evidently was very, very well built because it's still preserved even today.
The railroad track, the MKT, came through the Whelan farm. Do you have any recollections of the train coming?
Well, yes, I do, because it was always an important feature since it traversed the farm. Actually, it bisected one of our pastures from a field that was across the tracks. But I can remember going with my grandfather down to and across the railroad tracks, and always being warned, "Don't get your foot caught in a track." And I remember one occasion where we were crossing the track, and as we looked south, there was a train coming. It surprised me how quietly it was. Ordinarily, it would not blow its whistle, but would just stream on by. And as kids, my cousin and I would place pennies and nickels on the track and then look for them after it had gone by. But that was always a big warning. Don't walk on those tracks and get your foot caught in it.
There were sometimes people that would ride on the trains and
yeah, we would call those, and this was always a warning that was issued to us to watch out, and they called them tramps. And actually, I guess they were just people that were catching a ride on a train. Occasionally, we would see evidence that they had come up toward the house or the barn, and it was of some concern because you didn't know what they would do. But it was a typical picture where you had a long stick and then their belongings tied on that stick in a little piece of cloth. I remember one occasion where my younger brother Wilburn, at the time he was about 3 years old, but he comes screaming in the house about seeing a man walking down towards my aunt and uncle's house. And so that created quite a stir. We never really found out who exactly it was, but he was convinced it was some stranger. which was unusual because the farm was somewhat isolated.
Your father was in the Army and was in the CBI theater?
Yes, he was drafted into the Army within a week or two following December 7th, 1941. And his he went to Fort Sam Houston to to have his basic training. And when he received that basic training, his orders were to get on that train over there and stay on it till it stopped, and it stopped in Manitoba, Canada. And so he, his their job up there, he was put in the engineer corps, and their job was to build a place where planes could land in Canada. From that from that area, he was sent over to India and Burma, where he worked on the Alito Road, which was a road that was designed to alleviate the pressure that the Chinese had on them, because they had been surrounded by Japanese, and had there was no water access by ships to keep China in the war. So this was designed to be an overland route to China from India. And so that was what he did. Many stories in that regard, though.
When he came home, you your mother got notification that he would be at a certain place, but there was a little mix-up.
Well, at that time, there was the old ring, one ring, two rings, and the mouthpiece and the earpiece were two separate things. And my Uncle Clemens answered the phone, and it was his understanding that my dad had been discharged from the Army and that he would be in Austin. And he was, he asked to be picked up at a certain time. Uncle Clemens, as I say, had a little hearing problem. But at the appointed time, my grandparents, my mother and I were in Austin waiting at the train station, and he never showed up. His story was that, well, he got to Pflugerville and expected everybody to be waiting for him, and nobody was there. So he walked up to the post office, looked around, and then he was walking around by the bank and seeing some people that he hadn't seen in 3 years. And he, all of a sudden, up drives my grandparents, my mother and I, and stop. And there was, of course, a joyous reunion. And what I'm told about that reunion is that, of course, I was standing off to the side, and my mother and dad were hugging and kissing, and I saw this guy kissing my mama and hugging her. Supposedly I went up and yanked his trouser leg and said, "Hey, better stop that or I'm gonna tell my daddy on you." Of course, I don't remember that, but that was a story that was told, so.
We're gonna go to, you're going to first grade at the Pflugerville schools. Tell us about the building that you were in and your teacher.
Well, we lived along the south part of Pflugerville, and I forget the exact street, but I think it was about 3rd Street, and then farther south, about 3 or 4 blocks. And the town was really very small, and I remember that I was told that I hid in a closet on the first day of school, and my mother finally found me. My cousin had ridden his bicycle over from the farm, which was 3 miles away, and he come picked me up eventually when they found out where I was. I got on my bicycle, we rode down the hill, and then off to the schoolyard. And that was the first day of school. Interesting that my mother didn't take me. that we rode to school on a bicycle, and nobody thought anything of it.
What was the building like that you were in?
There was a barracks building with two classrooms in it, situated just a little bit northeast of where the old rock gym is. And the barracks building had a common entryway on the south side for the first and second grades. And our, we started out in the first grade. My teacher was Mrs. Buck. And we had a cloakroom where we put our coats. And the second graders would go into the other classroom, which was a little more east of ours.
There was a story that perhaps that building had come from the CCC camp?
As far as I recollect, that's what it was an old CCC camp barracks building from the 30s and 40s.
By the time you got to ninth grade, all of the boys took FFA, and that was a shop area. You want to talk about your FFA experience?
Yes, they had taken the classrooms out of the barracks building and made it into an FFA classroom with a workroom or working area on the east side, and then a classroom again on the west side. And Ms. George Simon was our ag teacher, and it was a required subject. We had to have 3 years of vocational ag, and in the work portion of that, we were taught all types of skills, such as working with wood lathe, welding, as well as animal and plant, animal husbandry and plants, seeds, corn, and so on. But it was a very, I would say, interesting and sometimes entertaining subject.
On the animals that you showed, they had a local stock show. Tell us about that and what you showed.
The first animals that I showed were Southdown sheep, and Mr. Simon, Jerry Nelson, superintendent's son, J.B. Marshall, Jr., and Edward Follick, and I all went to Colorado to pick up some Southdown lambs. And we brought those back in that single cab and short bed Chevrolet pickup, and we then raised those lambs to show. The first show that we would go to would be the Pflugerville Livestock Show, and it was a small show, but everybody would bring their sheep, their chickens, their steers, and whatever else they had to show. And we had a little small show that was always well attended. After that, then we would go to perhaps the San Antonio Livestock Show. But the main show that we showed for was the Austin Livestock Show, which was held in the old Austin City Coliseum. Those years I remember, especially with raising those sheep, not only did it give you something to do in the summertime, but at least as kids growing up, but it was something that I really thoroughly enjoyed for 3 years of raising those sheep. Mr. Simon was actually quite a character. He would take us out on ag field trips, and if you get that group of boys out, we'd travel out on the back of his pickup out to different farms and so on. It could be a pretty wild affair. He took all the antics good-naturedly, and there was nothing serious that ever happened. But when I look back, it was perhaps some of the things that were done were kind of dangerous, but nobody ever got hurt. But Mr. Simon was a good guy, and the kids just loved him.
Well, in today's world, there are laws about riding in the back of pickups. Y'all nearly rode and stood up many times. I think that pickup came from the Ackland Chevrolet Company.
That's right. It was donated to the school for the ag projects. And but I do remember one occasion where one of our classmates, they stopped at an intersection, and he jumped off the pickup, and then Simon took up, and Mr. Simon took off, and we all hollered at him, "Stop, stop," and the kid ran into the back of the pickup and didn't hurt himself, but could have. So you're right, it was could be a dangerous thing.
The animals you showed at Austin, did you receive any awards for?
Well, I did. In fact, I was very fortunate because I had the first year, I had Grand and Reserve Champion Southdown at the Austin show. And what was interesting is, looking back at it, is I paid $25 for the sheep. I had $25 in feed in it. It was the grand champion, and it brought $57. So I figured I'd come out pretty good. I made $7 profit that year. And it really never was the amount of money, but it was participation and competing and so on. So.
You also showed capons?
I did. And the capons were, they were just there. You put the food out for them, they ate it, and then you picked them up and took them to the show.
And did you win an award with your capon?
I did. I had a grand champion capon, and I think I paid $15 for it, and it brought about 50. So I was really doing good that year.
Now, you and your family lived in the city limits, and you had your FFA projects right there in your yard or barn on your property.
Right. Yeah, we moved to the city of Pflugerville in about 1954, and I was 11 years old when we moved there. And it was really advantageous because for the first time I could play Little League baseball, and also that I could participate in sports programs, because otherwise transportation to and from my house would have been very difficult. But we moved to a little house east of the railroad tracks, about 50 feet, and I don't really remember the name of the street.
Paul Street.
It has another name too, but Paul Street, we'll get it, yeah. And we moved there in 1954. It was, the house was about, as I say, about 80 feet from the railroad track. And I remember the first night we were there, the KT special come roaring through town about midnight with its light flashing and its horn blowing, and we all fell out of bed. It was such a shock. But after that, we got used to it. And really, the train track, the noise and all that didn't bother us a whole lot. But once again, we would put coins on the track.
Now, the railroad track made just a very slight curve, and then it crossed Pecan Street. It did not have any blinking lights or any...
It had a blinking light on the crossing.
At the end.
Yeah, but it was a, our dog got to, they would have a section hand that would come out and check the tracks regularly after each train went by. And the section hand people would taunt my dog. We had a big German Shepherd. It was a canine dog that my father had found, brought home, and we loved that dog. His name was Rennie. But he didn't like that section hand, and he got run over by the section hand. I can remember the day that it happened. We heard this yelp. We heard him barking, then heard a yelp, and then walked outside, and there was a section hand car lying off to the side of the track, and a couple of guys standing out there upset but unhurt, and our dead dog lying in the side by the railroad track. So we took him up in the pasture and buried him, and put a little wooden sign up that said, "Here lies Rennie." the best dog we ever had.
Do you remember any of the local men that were employed by the railroad?
I don't.
Your home was also built originally by the Durfler family. Tell us a little bit about what they did in town.
Well, you know, the only Durflers that I really ever knew was B.O. Durfler, and he ran a service station up in town and an oil company. There was a little garage that was in the back, and then our sheep shed, what we call a sheep shed. What I was told by somebody was that in previous days that had been a stagecoach stop in that area, but I don't have much information in that regard.
The Durflers also had a gin.
There was a small gin in the area that closed down long before we moved there, and there was residual concrete, iron, and an old well that was back at the little gin. I remember my uncles talking about working there in the 30s and perhaps even the 40s, and they made 50 cents a day, which was quite a bit of money in 1940.
The Donhoffer store was on Pecan Street, near where the gin site was. Did your family ever shop there?
Donhoffer's store was very easy to get to. It was a little bit outside of town, east of town, and they had just about everything that you needed in terms of groceries. It was right behind our house, as a matter of fact. We just had to crawl over the fence, and you could go right down there. And I remember going to that store very, very, very well with my grandparents and with my parents.
And that's present day, that was before you got to the Methodist Church. While you were living there, the Big Gin on the north side of Pecan was in operation. Tell us what life was like during ginning season in Pflugerville.
Well, as a kid, you were always looking for a job, and one job that I always coveted was running the sucker, which was a big round pipe that you moved around and sucked up the cotton and got it into the gin, and where they would make bales of cotton. But what I was told in later years, when I mentioned this to somebody who had run that sucker, said that was a hot, dirty job. But during ginning season, which usually started sometime in September and would run a lot of times through December, there would be literally hundreds of cotton trailers waiting for the cotton to be taken out of them and ginned. And if you had a real still day or night, especially night, where there was no wind and the cotton gin was running, the air would be so thick that it looked like you couldn't see more than about 50 feet. Now, since then, in medical school, you learned about pneumoconiosis, which cotton lint inhaled will cause some lung disease. But I don't think any of us ever suffered from that, except perhaps some clogged up sinuses.
Now, the cotton hulls were blown into a great big pile kind of to the east of the gym. How were cotton hulls recycled or used?
Well, in later years, they used them as mulch, but I don't know much about that.
They also had an oil mill. They would get cottonseed oil. And what was the purpose of cottonseed oil?
Well, cottonseed oil was used for cooking and things like that, but the mill was no longer there when we lived there.
And where were the cotton bales, once they were ginned, where were they
placed?
Okay,
they were put up, let's see, where El Rincon is where now, and it was an open area at the time. They would store the cotton bales up there, And in earlier years, they would also have medicine shows. And I do remember going up there with my grandparents and mother. You sit in your car and they have some type of a program. The guy would get up and talk and tell stories. And then he'd send a man around with a little bottle of liniment. As well as I can remember, it was Sloan's liniment, and for you to buy.
So when you were in school, you were involved in sports. At what age did you start playing football?
Our first junior high football program was begun by Mr. Hub Kimple. And we started out 6th, 7th, and 8th grades. And I can remember getting the uniform and how proud I was to put on the helmet, the shoulder pads, and then participate in a football game. The difference in size between a 6th and an 8th grader is quite a bit. But we still played even as 6th graders, 7th graders, 8th graders.
Where was your dressing room?
Our dressing room was in the old rock gym down along the north side. Not very big, all concrete, one little shower, and...
Did you have hot water?
I don't remember.
So who were some of the teams that you played in football?
Almost all the little teams around that we played are now huge towns. We played Hutto, Manor, Florence, Leander, Liberty Hill, sometimes Taylor, and then as you got up into the high school area, we played other schools that were a little farther off, such as Smiley, Prairie Lee, and Medina, Center Point.
So the team did well. What was the win-loss record?
In the 1958, the team began to win and didn't stop winning. Let's see, 58, 59, 60, 61, 62. Didn't stop winning for the next 5 years and had a 55-game winning streak, which at that time was a national record for high school.
What position did you play?
Well, I played halfback and quarterback and tailback at different times.
You were recognized as All-Central Texas running back?
I was. I owe most of that to my teammates. As I always told them, you know, you all blocked, and I just ran through the line like Tiny Tim tiptoeing through the daisies. They were exceptional ball players and great teammates.
Were there any special games that you particularly remember?
I do remember one at Johnson City, which our team was always very small. The biggest guy we had was 185 pounds, and a lot of them were sort of my size, which was around 155, maybe 160. But we had a lot of speed. But we played Johnson City, which outweighed us considerably, and we played in their field, on their field, and the final score was 13-12, which we eked out. And I'll never forget the way that game was won. It was won by a Hail Mary pass, and it was won by an extra point that was kicked, the only extra point we kicked all year long. And and it came about at game 25 or 6, halfway through what eventually became a 55-game winning streak. And so it was sort of the tip of the iceberg. It was the acme or whatever you want to call it.
You also ran track, or were in the track program. What were some of the events that you were in?
Well, I ran in the 100-yard dash, the 440, the mile relay, and the quarter mile, the 440 relay, and I broad jumped and pole vaulted. And I really wasn't all that fast. I could run a lot faster sideways than I could forward, which made me a not a bad running back. But and I always thought I could be a great pole vaulter. We pole vaulted with an old stiff aluminum pole that was about 2 inches in diameter. And we fell into not a lot of cushion. In fact, it was a sand pit, same pit that we jumped, broad jumped on. And I know, although I did win first place in the district meets, after that I just didn't go very high. But I know the third time I fell up at the Taylor district meet, I fell right on my sacrum. And I couldn't run very well for the next 3 months. And I always think that decreased my total speed. But I loved pole vaulting, except we really weren't equipped to do it.
Did the team have weights, or how did you build your strength, the team players?
We had one barbell and some weights. And our only, in terms of strength, it had to come just naturally or from baling hay. We hauled a lot of hay during the summer. And was what gave you a lot of strength and endurance, was just the hay hauling. We hauled a lot of it.
And who did you haul hay for?
I hauled hay for Charles Kimple. He was also our coach, and I owe Charles Kimple a lot because he gave me a first job. I forget what our wages were, but to haul hay, we got 2 cents a bale each. So for every three of us, we got 6 cents a bale for hauling the hay. But when I worked for Charles Kimple, I usually would run the cutter, mowing the hay down, and I was paid 75 cents an hour. Interesting that I owe a lot to the three Kimple boys, Charles Kimple, and then his cousin Hub Kimple, and Charles's brother Max, because all three of those got me jobs when I needed a job. And particularly when you're a kid growing up and you're a sophomore, junior, or even a senior in high school, just to have a little spending money meant you could actually go out on a date and you could put some gas in your car and you could buy your girlfriend a hamburger or take her to a movie. And so that was important. I mean, I got no allowance from my parents, so you had to make your money. And I...
What was your very first job, you and your brothers?
We chopped cotton. We had an old car. It was a 1946 Chevrolet that my younger brother, who was about age six, used to drive around our house, not on the streets or roads, but he stripped reverse and first gear out. So you could only drive that car in second, and then it would shift down into high. So you had to be careful where you parked so that you didn't have to back up to get out. And so we would, my brother Jimmy and I would go out to Mr. Jesse Bowles Sr., and we'd chop cotton. We'd chop cotton all week long and then work Saturday till about noon, and we made 50 cents an hour. Now, We get back in that car and we drive back home. I can remember being laughed at by the other kids in school, and I can really see why, because when the water pump started going out on that old car, I mean, you'd be driving down the road and it'd be screaming, it's zee, and you know, you couldn't go very fast. But, and you had, when I went to confirmation, you go up to the church, you had to park and make sure you could get out, park sort of downhill, and so, but it was okay.
The excitement in town, particularly for the young men, was sometimes going out to the tanks.
Yeah, I can remember, I never did participate in that, but those guys who had fast cars, I mean, like a 1957 Chevrolet or a 1957 Ford or 58 Ford or Chevrolet, or even a 55, as long as it was a V8, they would go out to the Railroad Avenue, which extended north out of Pflugerville. They'd get out into the country, and the tanks, butane tanks that were out there, sort of marked the end of the road. They marked off a quarter mile strip, and you'd have about four or five cars that would go out there, and then some would mark the start and some would mark the finish, and they would race there at night. As far as I know, nobody ever got hurt or anything, and nobody ever got caught.
It was what was the fastest car?
Well, it usually was the 1957 Chevrolet. Glenn Markson always had a really fast car. And he would go down to the Oak Hill Speedway and race down there. But sometimes I would try it with my 1951 Chevrolet and JB with his parents' 1954 Chevrolet. And we felt like we were really doing well, but you know, we're just going along pretty slowly.
Upon graduation from Pflugerville High School, what pathway did you take?
Well, in 1958 or so, Mr. George Simon asked me one day, let me see your hands. So I held my hands out to him, and he said, ah, the hands of a doctor. And so then, about a month later, he'd take me down to meet his doctor, who was a surgeon in Austin. And so we went down, I talked to him, and he told me several things. One of which, he says, okay, so you want to be a doctor. First thing you got to do is you got to put your heart in a deep freeze. Forget about love and marriage and all that kind of stuff. And anyway, so it got me into thinking, well, okay, I'll go into medicine. The only doctors I knew were the old family practitioners around. And, you know, I said, well, that's sort of what I'm going to do. I went to the University of Texas and enrolled in the pre-med program. And they had a program where you could go to medical school after 3 years and get your degree in something like zoology after a year in medical school. And so I decided to do that. And I spent 3 years at the University of Texas, and I got a scholarship. It was a tuition scholarship, and then another scholarship that helped me out considerably, plus my summer earnings, and eventually I got a loan. But I stayed at home, went to school that way, and drove with several people, including a Verna Jean Hebby, a Donnelly Wolf. We would drive down to the school, save money on gas, and so. Also, I worked at the university. I had jobs as a janitor. I had jobs at the LCRA delivering mail. I worked in the 7-Up bottling plant company, and I worked as a gopher at the city of Austin, working for a Mr. Kelly in the paving, street and paving department. So I worked, went to class, and I studied. And after 3 years, I was ready to get out of that place and got accepted in medical school in Galveston, as well as Southwestern, and decided to go to Galveston. It seemed like a friendlier place. And went to school down there for 4 years, a wonderful 4 years. I got married before I went down there. And my wife was of immense benefit, both at the University of Texas and at in medical school. She worked as a teacher, and we had plenty of money. I was just surprised how little we got by on. I think her salary was brought home about $225 a month, but we saved enough money we could buy our first black and white 19-inch television, Admiral TV, after about 6 months. So we did fine.
We'll go back to UT for a moment. You also worked at Buttercrust Bakery.
Yes, I did. Yeah, I worked at Buttercrust Bakery when I was 17. It was eye-opening because you got to work at night loading bread trucks. I did that for a summer, and you met some very interesting people. I also worked at nights at a North Austin, Texaco station. Worked from 6 o'clock at night till 8 the next morning. Coming from the little town of Pflugerville, it also was an eye-opening experience in terms of the people that come out at night in the sticks. From the sticks and from the, I don't know, from the back alleys of Austin. But, you know, nothing bad ever happened. It was just interesting.
So while you were at UT, you were able to go to some of the football games?
Yeah, I went to, you know, lots of the football games. Particularly when Texas would play Arkansas. But I was, you know, studying so much and so on. It was just football wasn't a big deal to me anymore.
After medical school, you came back to Austin.
Right. Came back, did my internship at Brackenridge Hospital. And they had several different rotations, emergency room, surgery, OB-GYN, medicine, pediatrics, and so on. My first rotation was nighttime ER at Brackenridge Hospital. And it was a true, true learning experience. I still value the help that the experienced nurses there in the emergency room gave me because, you know, even though you had had 4 years of medical school, what you saw and then what you had to do were two different things, and they helped me out immensely. And so after the internship was over, all of the other fellows in my internship class got drafted or went into the service. And so I waited for the draft. I called and asked when I was up. They said, "You're up next." And that was in 1968. And so I had a two-year-old child and a wife and family around in the area. So I decided, well, I think I'll probably better stick close by because I'm probably likely to get drafted. And so we stayed in Austin, and I went into family practice with a Dr. Francis McIntyre, and I started working. And it was a very busy practice. I got totally immersed in it, and I valued all the physician contacts that I had made during my year as an intern, using those who appeared to be excellent doctors as consultants, and I used a lot of them. And after 1 year, I decided to call and see where my draft status was, and they said, well, you're up next. So I said, okay, we'll just stick around again. Kept on doing family practice and getting busier and busier. And then I got the urge, you know, I want to do something besides family practice because I want to hone my skills a little better. So I applied for a radiology residency in several places, and I got a call from Dr. Schreiber down at the University of Texas Medical Branch in Galveston, and he says, so you want to come here and do, I said, yes, I do, and he said, okay, come on. I told him, well, I'm still draft eligible, and so I called my draft office and asked, what is my draft status? He says, well, you're still up, but we've lifted the freeze on enlistments in the Air Force and the Navy, and if you want to join those, I said, yeah, you know, I do. So I applied to the Air Force, and they said, we have an opening at Bergstrom Air Force Base in the reserves. I said, well, that'll be fine. So I went into the Air Force Reserves at Bergstrom and started there my last year in family practice.
The Bergstrom Air Force Base is presently where ABIA, the Austin International
correct.
Airport,
that's correct. That's correct. That's correct. It is. Anyway, I went down to get my radiology residency and enjoyed thoroughly the 3 years down there. And I had a few more kids at the same time. My daughter, Sherilyn, was born in 1971. Actually, there's a long story to that, too, but we won't go into that right now.
In your practice of medicine, you also were a team physician. When did that start?
I noticed early on, you know, when I was in high school, we didn't really have a team physician at the ball games. Even as a medical student, a sophomore medical student, I would go down to the sidelines and where when Fligger was playing, and I would ask, you know, and I'd be available because I figured I knew a little bit about some health care. But I actually began in 1968 after I'd finished my medical school and had the MD degree, standing on the sidelines at the Fleurville football games. And I continued that from 68 through 1971 until we went back to Galveston. While I was in Galveston, I did the football physicals for Alta Loma High School. And then we came back in 1975 and I began working once again with the Pflugerville football teams, doing their physical examinations as well as being on the sidelines. And that lasted until about 1986 or so. But I always enjoyed being out there on the field.
In 1970, Pflugerville's football team again went to the state finals, and that was played in San Angelo. Do you remember much about that game?
I remember it was a very cold night, and I think that the trip out there was difficult for the team, and I just don't think we were mentally ready to play. That's really the only thing I remember about that game. And they played, I'm trying to remember who they played. It was
Sonora
out in San Angelo, yeah.
But all of this was, again, volunteer, and that's been kind of an ongoing theme we see in the Pflugerville community of citizens stepping up to do things for others. In your career as a physician, you were involved or instrumental in at Round Rock Hospital and also in the eventual North Austin Medical Center. Talk about both of those hospitals coming online.
Well, the Round Rock Hospital was actually the first one that we put the radiology department in and got it started. And during its early in its development, and then we also participated in helping out Taylor Hospital. But the main, our main thrust was the North Austin Medical Center, and we basically designed the first radiology department that was in place when it opened. And so those were unique times to be a part of that sort of venture.
In your radiology practice, you traveled around Central Texas. What were some of the towns that you served?
During my first years at the Austin Diagnostic Clinic, we also had a circuit that we would ride out and do radiology. We would go out to University of Texas Health Center, and from there we would go to Georgetown Hospital and Medical Center, and from there to Taylor, and then we would also go to Burnet and to Lampasas, and we did the radiology in those areas for many years.
Over the course of your career, technology also impacted your means of treatment to some extent. Talk about that difference.
Immensely. It's interesting that in my last year in radiology training, the thought and publicity going around was that it was going to be difficult for radiologists to find a job. And at the same time, technology was changing. As soon as I got out of my training as a radiologist in 1975, along comes ultrasound, probably one of the greatest innovations in imaging that you could find. And then along comes CT scans, which is even surpasses ultrasound in its imaging capabilities. And then along comes MRI, magnetic resonance imaging. And along those same lines, nuclear medicine was changing and PET scanning come along. So the technological improvements in just the imaging part of medicine have just been mind-boggling. And to keep up with all of that has also been difficult. In fact, now you have sort of ultra-selective specialties that necessarily have had to develop. And there's other areas in imaging, such as mammography and so on.
So you really were a lifelong learner and having to stay up from nearly year to year with
absolutely.
I want to talk a little bit about the development of Little League fields. You were instrumental at both the Balcones Little League and the Pflugerville Little League complex.
The Balcones Little, well, let me go back to the first Pflugerville Little League. It was all played on the old ball field, which is sort of south of the present fire department. And it was a great field. I mean, it had no fence on the outside, around the boundaries, just a backstop. But a lot of kids played Little League baseball there. And the high school teams played baseball there. And when we moved back to the area in 1975, we had experience, we had an experience over at Balcony's Little League, which they had just bought some land and built that area up and made a very nice Little League, Senior League, and Softball League ballpark. And I watched W.C. Kalanick be very instrumental in helping to build those fields. And our kids played there a couple of years. And then we decided to move to the Pflugerville area. And we needed a place to put a Little League field. We played the first year at, again, the old ballpark. And so I saw that W.C. Kalanick had moved to the area, and so we started talking about the advantages and the reasons why we needed a Little League ballpark. And so we began to look around at different school sites, since we didn't necessarily want to have to buy the land. And so W.C. and I went to one of the school board members. His name was Leonard Daring, and said, "Leonard, you know, we're kind of interested in finding a spot to put a Little League ballpark. Could we go around and look at some of the school sites and see if there's some land available? Because it could be very advantageous for both the school and for the ball players to have something maybe in combo." So we went out and we looked across from where Emmanuel Lutheran Church is, and on a little bit further east at where an elementary school was, and they had a large vacant area along the south side. And we said, "Leonard, what about that area?" He said, "I think that's a good one." We went to the school board, and the school board under Mr. Hyman, I think, was the superintendent, and Leonard was on the school board, but they agreed to let us use the ball fields. And so mostly under W.C.'s tutelage and his ability to get contact, we were able to erect a field within a year or so. And you look out there now, and it's just a wonderful little ballpark with Little League, Minor League, Senior League, and then softball fields as well. A great location, and the school has continued to be very supportive of this endeavor.
So how many years did you coach Little League?
It was somewhere around seven.
Okay, so volunteerism, as we said earlier, has been very, very integral in this city. So you've served on the Emmanuel Lutheran Church Council, Little League, a team physician, Lions Club. Any service projects you all do in Lions?
Well, the Lions Club's middle name is service, and it's an international organization. It's also a state organization and locally. And this club was formed in 1975, and it has been a real benefit to the entire community, to a lot of nonprofit organizations, and to the school system. We also send kids to the Texas Lions Camp, as well as some dues, and the Texas Lions Camp's up in Kerrville, and the children that we've sent up there have disabilities of various types, including a diabetes camp. And the people who go up there just thoroughly enjoy or come back and appreciate the fact that the Lions Club has made it possible for their children to go up there. Also, we help the school nurses out a lot with kids that are needy. We have we help out with the school lunches and the food pantries.
The Lions participate in the Deutschenfest. And you had an early experience with Deutschenfest with the Wursterito. Tell us about that.
As I recollect, the German club had a booth, and there was some bright person who come up with the idea of a Wursterito, which is a hot sausage. And you put on that hot sausage, put it on a bun, and you put mustard on it and perhaps chili. But the name was rather unique, Wursterito. And the name fit. It was a great seller. And I don't know if that name was branded or not, but it should have been.
Okay, we're going to talk about town characters. That you recall from the town. Do you remember Mr. The Constable Blackman?
Yes, I do remember some bits about him. I know that he always had a cigarette hanging from his mouth, that he was respected in town. He would be a caricature of the old sheriff. Not to demean him, but he was very low-key, and I really don't remember a whole lot about him, except that I remember one time he handcuffed a guy and lost a key, and they had to go get him cut off, but I'm sure that wasn't characteristic of him.
So he walked the streets rather than drove a car?
I think he drove a car. I don't know that much about that.
Go ahead, other characters.
I better not mention those.
Chuck Knabel.
Okay.
He was one of the early aldermen for the city for about 10 or 12 years elected. Mm-hmm. Had a business.
Yeah, tough. I knew him when he had the tavern right next to the meat market, and he had a pool hall, and it was a gathering place. You go in there and drink a Coke and play pool, and he was always very friendly, and I think participated a lot in the city as well as in the church.
Unair-conditioned windows open?
Yeah, it was unair-conditioned. They had some big fans occasionally in the summertime.
Mr. J.B. Marshall.
J.B. was a real character, you're right. And I liked him a lot. He was my dad's best friend. he was his hunting buddy. He also coached Little League. The old hunters always had a great time. He was one of the old hunters. It was never usually about the biggest buck you got or the biggest fish you caught, but it was more about the relationships and antics and the adventures and misadventures. And JB was a big part of some of those misadventures. Vernon Flugger was, of course, a lawyer in town. And he was very helpful to a lot of people in this community.
John Flugger.
Well, John, the first time I ever met or knew him, he was a teller at the bank. I was about 13 or 14 years old. And when I would come in, he'd call me by my first name. And he took his time to kind of acquaint me with the way a bank works. And when I put my first $10 into a bank account, he helped me set up my bank account. And was always had an interest in whatever I was doing, and so I liked John. In later years, I used him as a consultant in real estate matters, and in fact, got a loan from him to build my house. And later on, he asked me if I wanted to be one of the bank directors, which I agreed to. And so John was a straight-up guy, and you could always, if you wanted to know the truth about something, John would give it to you.
Your dad and Mr. Lang, and I don't know if John may have been involved, actually helped provide some housing to a part of Pflugerville.
Yes, my dad and John had a construction business and built quite a few houses around town. And then Albert Lang was another business associate of Dad's. Albert Lang had been instrumental in the Capitol Memorial Cemetery, but then he came out to Pflugerville, and he and my dad built and renovated a lot of houses.
Albert, I think, also had the very first pet cemetery in the area.
He did.
Probably in all of Central Texas.
Up in the Three Points area, he did.
In closing, what do you see the community, the city of Pflugerville being in, say, 2, 5, 10, the next 50 years?
I have a difficult time estimating exactly what it's going to be like. I think that just the fact that when I drive around town now, I'm just astounded at all the building that's gone on. I think that there certainly is a desire to increase the quality of life in Pflugerville, and I see where some of these things that have been done in the last year or couple of years will do that. I would say that the biggest problem is going to be controlling the growth and managing it.
Okay, thank you very much for your service in so many arenas and for making a difference in the community.